always felt that writers should be read and heard only occasionally. You know, 30 or 40 years ago, a writer wasn't a face. You know, he was just a name if he was successful. And you could pass maybe a famous writer on the street without recognizing him or her. But since television came in and now the internet, it's people who used to be anonymous at one time are sometimes become celebrities. And I'm a very shy person, normally. The reason I prefer writing for children is that I get a very sincere and frank response from young readers. Adults will sometimes be polite, and even if they find a book of mine boring, they will say it's very interesting. But a young reader, if he finds a book boring, he'll say so. And while I was, I think, still in class 8 or 9, I wrote a little story. It was all about my class fellows and even my teachers. And I think I made some funny remarks about some of the teaching staff. And I'd written this book, a little long story in an exercise book or copy. And my class teacher found it and took it away to read. And then I was summoned to the office next day because I'd made some disparaging remarks about the principal. And so he tore it up. So that was the end of my first book. So if while you're at school you're going to write a book or a story, don't put your teachers in it or principal in it. play safe. I lost my father when I was young, but my mother sent me off to England. And while I was there, I had to work because I didn't have money for going to college or university. So I took different jobs. And in the evenings, I would sit down and write my first novel, which was called The Room on the Roof. And I was always longing to come back to India. I didn't realize how much I would miss this land until I went away. I was very homesick. I missed friends. I missed the place I grew up in, people I'd loved. And I determined to come back as soon as I could. So when I finally found a publisher for this first book, which was called The Room on the Roof. And in those days, they gave you an advance of £50. £50 was the standard advance. Now it's 5,000 or 50,000, but it was then just 50. But you could come back to India in £50. You came by sea in those days, and it was just £40. So with £40, I came back and landed at Bombay, but still with £10 in my pocket, which brought me home to Dehradun, where my mother was staying. And then I began freelancing. That is, freelancing in those days, it meant really bombarding the newspapers and magazines with articles and stories, because there were very few publishers around. That is, publishers of general books or fiction or literature. There were publishers of school books and textbooks, but very few of the sort of publishers that we have today and who publish my books now. So it was really a matter of writing for newspapers like the Indian Express, which in those days had the Sunday Standard in Bombay, and the Statesman and the Times of India and the Hindustan Times, all old established newspapers, and the Illustrated Weekly of India, which was a very well-established magazine published from Bombay. So for 2 or 3 years I did this, and I'd make 300 or 400 rupees a month, because in those days you didn't get more than 50 rupees for a story. But 1955, you could live on 300 or 400 a month. Today you would need 30,000 or 40,000. And as for my own books, well, there are now about 120 of them in print. Because I've been writing for 60 years or more, so the stories have accumulated. And the books have increased, so I've gone past my century, but would like to write a few more. And God willing, will do so. Maybe I'll read a short poem or two, and then a story, and then maybe tell you one, because these are short poems, so you won't fall asleep. So if mice could roar, and elephants saw, and trees grow up in the sky, if tigers could dine on biscuits and wine, and the fattest of men could fly, if pebbles could sing, and bells never ring, and teachers got lost in the post, if a tortoise could run, and losses be won, and bullies be buttered on toast, if a song brought a shower, and a gun grew a flower, this world would be nicer than most. This land is mine. This land is mine, although I do not own it. This land is mine because I grew upon it. This dust, this grass, this tender leaf and weathered bark, all in my heart are finely blended until my time on earth is ended. And this is for students here. Dare to dream, build castles in the air, but first give them foundations. Hold fast to all your dreams, make perfect your creations. All glory comes to those who dare. Failed works are sad, lame things. Act impeccably, sing your own song, but do not take another's song from her or him. Look for your art within. You'll find your own true gift, for you are special too, and if you try, you'll find there's nothing you can't do. And I'll conclude with a funny poem which I wrote while I saw some school children doing the hip-hop in a school here. Hip-hop Nature Boy, it's called. When I was 7 and climbing trees, I stepped into a hive of bees. Badly stung and mad with pain, I danced the hip-hop in the rain. Hip-hop, I'm a nature boy, Mother Nature's pride and joy. When I was 12, still climbing trees, I fell instead and landed on my head. Feeling lighter, I thought I might become a writer. Hip-hop, dancing in the rain, a nature writer I became. With nature being my natural bent, at 20, I took out my tent and spent the night beside a nadi, wearing only vest and chadi. At crack of dawn, I woke to find a crocodile was close behind and smiling broadly. In times of crisis at my best, I did not trouble to get dressed, but fled towards the Gulf of Kutch with fond salams to Magarmach. Mother Nature once again found me dancing on the plain, nanga panga in the rain. Growing older, even bolder, took a winding mountain trail, up a hill and down a dale, all to see a mountain quail. The quail was extinct, long expired. I was limping very tired. Thought I saw a comfy cot in the corner of a hut. Feeling grateful, I sank down upon a blanket soft as down. Blanket rose up all at once, gave a shudder, then a pounce. Stumbling in the darkness there, I disturbed a big brown bear. I did not stop to say good night, but fled into the open night, hip-hop in the rain, dancing to that old refrain. Growing old, I thought it safer in my tryst with Mother Nature to grow flowers, roses, dahlias, poppies, sweet peas, rare azaleas, candy tuft and tiny tansies, violets, sweet and naughty pansies. A lovely garden I'd constructed. Birds and bees were soon inducted. Did I say bees? They were buzzing all around me, angry, diving down upon me. For where their hive had been suspended, by accident it lay upended. Dear reader, if you must in nature put your trust, stay away from swarms of bees and strange crocs lurking under trees. or else, like me, you will dance with pain while doing the hip hop in the rain.
Thank you.
We who love books, I think this is very pertinent to this literary festival. Some books I'll never give away, though old and worn, their binding torn, upon my shelves they'll always stay, alive, still read, still fresh each dawn, their magic moments never gone. Great verse, great thoughts still stand the test of time that's passing by so fast. These good companions never fail to give us joy, to nourish us. We who love books will always be the lucky ones, our minds set free. When I was a small boy and I was left in a forest-stressed house in the jungle, and the shikaris, including my mother and stepfather, had all gone off hunting, and I was sitting in the veranda of this rest house, reading a book, when I looked up and I saw this huge tiger in the clearing. And the tiger was looking at me in a rather hungry fashion. And I jumped up and ran indoors, shut the door of the guest house, the front room, and then ran to the window and looked out, and the tiger was still there. It had come closer. I closed the window. Then I remembered there was a door at the back of the bungalow. And I ran there and shut that, looked out of the nearest window, and the tiger had circled the dark bungalow, and it was coming closer and circling round, and I was running around shutting doors and windows in a panic, quite on my own. And then thud, 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 I could hear its paw banging against the front door. And I pulled a table into the center of the room, put a chair on the table, got on the chair, climbed up. There was a little skylight in the top, and I got through the skylight onto the roof. And as I did so, the dog came in with a crash, and this tiger charged into the front room with a roar, and finding I wasn't there, or that his meal wasn't there, he started breaking furniture and wrecking the place. And dashed out again. Fortunately, he couldn't get up to the roof. And by that time, the forest guard came, fired in the air, and the tiger took off. So after that, I have mixed feelings about tigers. I'm not exactly fond of them. Thank you. The life of an author is becoming hectic, but it shouldn't be. And it wasn't in the beginning. And nowadays, in the world today, nothing is private anymore. When you are writing, in other words, when you are at work, no one is watching you. And is there any other profession in the world which you can undertake without anyone watching you? It's very hard to think of something like that. To write well and in your language, in English or whatever language you wish to write in, is also a great advantage to you, regardless of what career you choose, because you can be a doctor or an engineer or a scientist or a businessman, but if you can write well, that will help you tremendously. The ability to write well gives you a tremendous advantage. Stories are about people. Everyone has a story to tell, or more than one. And if you're interested in people, a writer must be interested in people, otherwise he won't have any stories to tell. Of course, occasionally you run out of people. When I run out of people, I write ghost stories. You can always make up a ghost or two. But basically, it's people. That's the inspiration you need. Literature and the arts have always been associated with insecurity. Because if you go back and look at the history of literature, you'll read about poets starving in garrets and writers out on the streets. And these stories of failure exceed the stories of success. And although maybe things are better today, and certainly there is now a boom in publishing, and books are coming out all over the place, some writers are very successful, making money, but they're the exceptions, remember. It's still very hard to get a book published. It's very hard to sell a book, as most publishers will tell you. So it's a very difficult profession. And so I think parents, naturally they don't want their children to be at risk. So they would always suggest some safe profession or popular profession. But if you write well and you have confidence in yourself, then go ahead and do it. Mm-hmm.